We're about to go teach our sweet, 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 sweet friend how to download the UCC Hub app.
Because you're gonna need it.
So we want to just kind of like...
We want to walk you through it.
Yeah. Have you guys be along with us in this process, because it's going to be fun, it's going to be interesting,
and we are going to get a sweet treat out of it.
This is true. So stay tuned.
Freezer burn.
You want to try on the seat?
Maybe.
Yeah, the bomb is better.
No, it's on.
Okay, I'm on.
I can see it now.
Okay. So you guys are both gonna go to your app store.
Okay.
My app store.
I
had it. And then type in UCC Hub.
Okay. UCC.
Oh no.
No, I don't want to do that. We'll just.
Yep. Just type. You'll just type at the very top. UCC Hub. Mm-hmm. Good job.
Search.
And search it, Sharon.
Yeah. And there it is.
There it is. And do you guys know how to watch on Sunday morning? What you're gonna do?
Yes, there's a rectangle here and it says just click and you get it.
Click the stream.
Click and get it.
Click.
I did last Sunday. You watched on Sunday?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah. Oh, social distancing.
Oh, right.
If you want to do something different and you want to do your sermon notes, your sermon notes are going to be right here. Yes. So you can go ahead and click those.
Okay.
And they'll be... You'll be able to just click to your sermon notes.
Okay.
Hold down.
Sermon notes.
Mm-hmm. This is for last week, right?
This is for last week. It's not updated yet.
Okay.
So you can see you have your sermon notes, you have your order of service there, and then is that your church news?
Uh-huh.
So you can still look at things like you could if you were at service.
Okay.
If you guys follow along in the Bible reading plan, or if you want to, or if you already do, the Bible reading plan is right there. So you just click on that, and it'll ask you to browse for plans. Yep, page.
Okay.
You have your Bible, so if you need your Bible, you know, they say turn to this.
Oh, neat.
Yep, your Bible's right there.
Neat.
So
I didn't know that.
Yeah, and you can change your versions and then change the book of the Bible up there. And then you have a journal right there, too.
I just usually put into my search column on my opening page. Yeah. I Google.
Well, this will be easier.
This is easier.
So, Yep.
You're good.
And it says you can add or share.
Yep. You can share the app with a friend. So maybe scroll down and let's see how that. Maybe just hit that plus button. We'll see what happens. So you can do that on. It says Facebook, Twitter, or more options. Maybe hit more options.
What is an AirDrop?
That is. So if my phone is open and Jean's phone is open, anyone's phone is open, you can go to AirDrop, click that button.
Oh, is there?
All right, and so if you want to sign up to give online, you'll click this button.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a couple different ways. I won't have you probably go all the way through it right now, but you could either hit online or just do a text message.
Okay.
You would probably, I don't know how you guys give currently, but you could easily just hit that button, or you can go get on your computer and or you can send a check-in. This is like your Connect Guard.
Yes,
So that's your first time guest or someone if you're updating your contact or if you want to get plugged in somewhere into a certain area or you want to serve.
Okay.
You would hit that. So like say you guys move, I would just fill that out so you can, we'll just have Sharon click. I think the big thing is, the best thing is for you guys to know how to watch.
Yeah.
And just being able to click that button.
We're going to be there for a while.
Yep. And you also, there's these, you do see these little, these scroll over right here?
Yes.
And
yes.
So there's our social medias on here too. So if you're ever like the kids zone.
Oh yes.
And they're doing a ton of work, the high school, middle school, and the youth, like the children's programming to get everything online right now. So there's a lot happening on those platforms. So that could be helpful if you have families with younger kids to show them that maybe. Mm-hmm. Or just so then you know. So that's on the social app.
We love you guys.
Welcome to University Christian Church. This is our traditional service, and I am so glad that you are tuning in and watching us online. It is incredible times that we live in. It truly is beyond anything I have ever experienced, but we are here as the body of Christ to worship, to praise our Lord, to hear an amazing message from our pastor, lead minister Barry Park. And we're so excited that we could gather together around computers and TVs and phones, actually around the country, around the world, and celebrate Jesus Christ. Won't you pray with me? Father God, thank you so much for your grace we have in Jesus Christ. Thank you for just being the God that you are, that loves us and cares for us and knows exactly what we're going through. And you understand the times we live in. You understand the hurt and the pain and the uncertainty and the fear and all those things that are happening around us, and you're right here with us. So we thank you for that. Thank you for your grace, but also your peace that we can have when the crisis hits, when the world around us crumbles. Thank you for being the God that we can depend on and always trust and always lean on. So today we want to worship you. We want to honor you with all that we are. In Jesus' name, amen.
We begin this morning with a reading of Scripture from Revelation 5. Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands, and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders.
In a loud voice, they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise."
Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever."
Behold the Lamb.
Revelation 4. Whenever the living creatures give glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and ever,
they fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They lay their crowns before the throne and say,
"You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being."
Awake my
Colossians 1. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation.
For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together.
And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy.
Please take a moment to grab some bread and juice and have communion in your home. Feel free to pause the video here. A virus that shuts down the global economy, threatens lives, and drives everybody into home seclusion. They're probably going to write stories about this, the kind of things that my kids are going to tell their grandkids about. But I want to remind you of a few other stories that I've read about. A guy named Noah, who built an ark in the middle of nowhere, packed his family and two of each kind, jumped on that boat, locked the door, and survived a flood that killed everything on earth. Oh yeah, he was 600 years old. A guy named Moses, who the Lord used to free his people from Pharaoh. A staff that turned into a snake, 10 plagues, water to blood, frogs, boils, hail, big, scary stuff. And the story about Jesus, our Savior, born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, was crucified, died and was buried, and 3 days later, rose again. We serve a big and mighty God. One who loves us so much that he sent his only son to be sacrificed so that we could be forgiven for our sins and that we could enter into a relationship with him. Please take the bread and the juice and remember the incredible sacrifice that Jesus made for us. Please pray with me. Father God, you are worthy of praise. Thank you for your love and your grace. We ask for your forgiveness for our sins. Father, we ask that you watch over us during this trying time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I read something this last week has really stuck with me, and that is when we honor the church, we're honoring God. And I've been thinking about that because, like all of you, in this COVID-19 outbreak and all this mess that's going on, I'm incredibly concerned about finances, my finances, and the financial position of all of you and our church's finances. Our economy is so complex, and it's intertwined, and right now it is very, very unsure. And yet in these scary times, we see beautiful outpourings of generosity. I just love to read those almost every day. There's families delivering food to the elderly. There's people donating, even making masks for frontline medical workers. Even the NBA stars covering the lost salaries of arena workers. That one just amazes me. But it's encouraging to see folks really respond to the needs around them in this time of crisis. But during this unprecedented time of just countless unknowns, I want to encourage all of us to encourage or to continue giving to the church. Now, I may sound like some kind of manipulating televangelist, but church is not some nice charitable organization. It's truly not. Something spiritually, uniquely happens when you give to your church, something that goes far beyond just helping to pay pastor salaries and building mortgages and program costs. In Malachi chapter 3, verse 10, it says, "Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, so there will be enough food in my temple. If you do, says the Lord of heaven's armies, I will open the windows of heaven for you. I will pour out a blessing so great you won't have enough room to take it in. Try me. Put me to the test. Then all the nations will call you blessed, for your land will be such a delight, says the Lord of heaven's armies. You know, every time I get paid, whether my check is big or small or growing or shrinking, every time when I give the first fruits of my income to God through the local church, I'm making a tangible declaration to myself and to my family that God is my ultimate provider. He is the foundation of my trust. Now, tithes and offerings aren't some kind of snake oil that wards off economic collapse and physical sickness. Doesn't do that. In fact, suffering is part of the Christian experience, and Jesus promised that. But I want you to understand that giving is an outward expression of an inward commitment that Jesus is where your trust is firmly rooted in this tumultuous season. We have three possible ways for you to give. Online, of course, with our website, our UCC Hub phone app. You can mail a check in, and you can let us know if you want self-addressed stamped envelopes. We will send those to you. And there's a secure drop box right next to our office door. So let's continue to be a generous church. Let's continue to be the church that we've been so we can continue to boldly share the good news of Jesus, and we can support our missionaries that are right here in Manhattan and around the world proclaiming the gospel of Jesus. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you. We thank you for your grace in Jesus, but more and more as we look at the world around us, we thank you for your provision and what you provide for us in bodily needs and physical needs and health needs and spiritual needs. And you gave us Jesus, and that's, we need him the most. So thank you. I thank you for this church and the tremendous generosity we've seen. And I ask you to bless, put your blessing upon all those who watch today, all those who are part of what we do here. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And one programming note, Chris Morrison is bringing the message today, not Barry Park. I got corrected. So he's got a powerful message today.
Hello, University Christian Church. My name is Ethan Greer, and I work with Mustard Seed Network here in Kyoto, Japan, at Mustard Seed Christian Church in Kyoto. First of all, thank you so much for supporting us and partnering with us. It's through these kinds of partnerships that the mission is able to move forward. So thank you for your prayers, your encouragement, your support. You probably already know this, but Mustard Seed Network is a network of church planting churches in urban Japan. We seek to glorify God by making disciples through planting gospel-centered churches. We want to see Japan saturated with and impacted by the gospel-centered churches that further the global cause of Jesus Christ. We try to catalyze church plants. We support church planters and their churches, and we want to recruit and train more church planters as well. Here in Kyoto, just like the rest of the world right now, probably the biggest news is COVID-19 and the effects that it's having on society. Throughout Japan, public gatherings have ceased for the past few weeks. And so we've been utilizing technology and been doing online services. We hope to see this change really soon as the cases in Japan have slowed. But it's been a unique opportunity. Obviously, probably very similar to what you're experiencing. This is not ideal, but it gives us a unique opportunity to fellowship in a way that we wouldn't have had otherwise. In the midst of all of this, 2 weeks ago, there's a young man, I'll call him E. His name starts with E. He was baptized. He'd been coming to church for a long time, for a few months, and he'd really been investigating Christianity. First time we talked, he told me, I feel like following God is slavery and living for myself is true freedom. And so we got to talk about how living for yourself is really selfish, self-centered, and it can be really hurtful to yourself and others. It doesn't honor God. And we talked about all the grace that God gives us and that we need from Him. And so he came to believe that there's salvation in Jesus from his sins. And he got baptized just a couple weeks ago. And so now we are brothers in Christ. Mustard Seed Network wants to see more of that. We have a vision to continue proclaiming the gospel and making disciples, calling people to repent and believe the gospel. Right now there's 5 church plants in urban areas in Japan, but we hope to have 12 by the year 2025. And so that is only possible by God's power. So we need your prayers. We need your encouragement. We need your support. Please pray for more churches, more church planters, and more disciples in Japan. Again, thank you so much for partnering with us here. I really look forward to what God is going to do, even in the midst of this difficult time.
Easter is happening, online only. Stay up to date by going to university.church/Easter, and here you'll find all the details about how Easter will look. You'll also find links to our Kids Zone page where you'll be able to find access to activities, videos, and other resources to experience Easter as a family.
Some people think Baptism Sunday isn't happening. Well, guess what? It still is, but we're calling it Baptism Sunday. That's right, Baptism Sunday. So really all you need in order to be baptized on Baptism Sunday is a tub and someone to baptize you. And we believe that any baptized believer can baptize another person. So if you'd love to be baptized on Baptism Sunday, which is Sunday, April 19th, then please go to our website, university.church, and click the Get Baptized button on our main page.
Good Friday is coming up. Good Friday is a day where we take time to remember the death of Jesus on the cross for our sins and prepare our hearts for Easter. On Friday, April 10th, we will be hosting our Day of Prayer. From 3 to 6:30, you can join us live on Facebook or our website, university.church, to participate. From 3 to 6, you'll have live worship, scripture reading, and prayer led by a small group of staff and volunteers. And at 6, we will have a short message from one of our pastors.
We're going to be adding 2 additional service times at 4:30 and 6 p.m. These are to help all of you have an opportunity to engage in online services. We know not everyone can make it to the morning service, or maybe you have more than one service you would like to watch. Please help us tell everyone by sharing this post on your timeline and stories. We hope to see you at one of our service times on Sundays, either 8, 9:20, 11, 4:30, or 6.
Welcome. We want to welcome all of you that are tuning in online to watch our church services and be a part of our church services. This has certainly been a different time for all of us, and so we're learning to do this. I want to welcome both our contemporary crowds as well as our traditional crowds. Thank you for tuning in. It's been neat to see all of you engage online and tune into our services, and so just want to say welcome to you. And we'd also love to just welcome all of our military out there, those both near and far. We know you guys tune in and watch our services either live or a replay of our services, and that means the world to us. And we want you to know we love you, we're thinking about you, and we're praying for you as well in this time wherever you're at. And then our students as well. We just want to say hi and welcome all of our students, and maybe you're back home with your family now, and we welcome you and your family. Thank you for tuning in and engaging with us online. We just love getting to do that, and we're glad and grateful that you tune in. And lastly, the last group of folks I want to welcome is those of you who are new. We have had quite a few folks who who are just new to our church family and new to UCC and been tuning in online. And I just want you to know, we're super excited that you're tuning in and maybe giving church a chance again for the first time in a long time, or maybe you're just exploring the claims of Jesus. And I'm glad that you've tuned in here. And we've got a phenomenal story that Jesus teaches today. And I believe he wants to speak to you. And so I just want to welcome you. Today, we get to I get to close out our series called No Perfect People. And through this series, we've kind of been talking and discussing about how the church is a place for the imperfect, that there are no perfect people here, and that if it was a perfect place, the minute we stepped into it, it would essentially become imperfect. And so God's church is the perfect place for imperfect people. And that's the bottom line of our message today is God's church, his family and his gathering is the perfect place for imperfect people. Today we're going to talk about, we're going to look at one of the probably most famous stories out of the Bible. If you've been in church for a while or if you've been around church at all, you've probably heard of the story of the prodigal son, and it's in Luke chapter 15. So if you have your Bibles there at home on the couch, you can start turning there now. We're going to be diving into Luke chapter 15. And real quick, I thought, you know, there was, before I was a believer and even early on, I never knew what the word prodigal meant. And so I just wanted to share the definition as we jump in. The definition of the word prodigal means lavishly or recklessly living, or to be wastefully extravagant. And so today we're looking at a story about actually two sons, and one of them is known as the prodigal. But the beauty of this story and the beauty of God's heart in this message is not just to speak to the prodigal, but I believe he also wants to speak to what I would call the perfectionist son as well, if you will. And God's just got a great message for us here, and I'm excited to share. So if you would, we're going to jump in Luke chapter 15, verse 11. It starts like this. And he said, "There was a man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the property that is coming to me.' And so he divided his property between them. And not many days later, the younger son gathered all that he had, and he took a journey into a far country and squandered it on reckless living." You see, you have to catch the cultural moment here that's going on, because in their time frame and in their culture, the son saying to his dad, "Hey, dad, I don't want you, I want your stuff." Is essentially him saying, it's like telling your father, "I wish you were dead," because the reality was, in this time frame, you didn't get your inheritance until your father had passed on. And so he's essentially saying to his dad, "Dad, you're dead to me. I don't want you. I want your stuff." And the story goes on. And it says, "And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country. He sent him into his fields to feed his pigs, and he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and yet no one gave him anything. But when he had come to himself," and I want you to, if you're at home right now, I want you to just remember that, catch that. "When he had come to himself," some translation would say, "when he had come to the end of himself." It says, "When he had come to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread? But I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your servants.'" If you're reading this story and you're listening, this is like that quintessential high school screw-up moment, if you will, where you know you've made a big mistake, and you know you've made a mess of something, and now you're rehearsing the speech that you're going to give to mom or to dad in the mirror, and this is essentially what he's doing. As the passage says, he had come to the end of himself. He knew that he had made a mess of this thing. And so he says, "Maybe, just maybe, I don't deserve to be a son anymore, but maybe I can go home to my dad and maybe he'll take me back as a hired hand, as a servant. That would be certainly better than where I've brought myself to." It says, "And he arose and he came to his father, but while he was still a long way off, the father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and he kissed him." That's one of the most beautiful passages of this whole story right there. He says, but while he was still a long way off, the father ran to embrace him. You have to understand that in this moment, this is one of the messiest moments that you can think of. This son here, he was in a pig pen. This is not like he cleaned himself up and came home to dad. He's messy, and he was in a pig pen with manure and the slop that was fed to pigs with nothing. He had nothing, and he comes home to his father, and dad sees him. His dad and his father sees him a long way off, and what does he do? But he runs to him. The father runs, and he embraces his son, and here's the deal, and the first point is simply this: is the father pursues those who know they're not perfect. Translation, the father loves his messy children. I don't know where you're at today in your life, but maybe this is your story. I mean, maybe some of you are sitting there and you're watching, and you don't really even know why, but you've tuned in, and at the end of the day, this is you. You're the prodigal, and you've made a mess of your life. Maybe you've financially wrecked and ruined yourself and your family, and you don't know what to do. Now, maybe it's an affair that you've been caught in, and if it comes out or comes to light, you don't know what will happen. Maybe it's anxiety or depression that you've just wallowed in and gone to the bottom of, and you don't know where to go from here. And I would simply say the Father is pursuing you, and he's coming in, and the response that you would get if you would turn to him would be him running and embracing you in love and compassion. You see, the Father, he's pleading with you. If that's your story, the Father in the story is pleading with you to come home. He's saying, come home, and when you do, I'll lavish you in love. It doesn't matter where you've been or how far you've gone, but I think for most of us, for some of us, if you're the prodigal, you think you've gone too far. And I would simply say this to you, is that you cannot out-sin the cross of Christ. There's nothing that you can do that would separate you so far from God that he can't redeem you, and that the Father isn't running after you, because the Father pursues his children who are a mess. And so a couple questions I'd just ask you to maybe consider. As you listen and as you think about this, is what's stopping you from coming home? Maybe for some of you, you just haven't, as the passage says, you haven't come to the end of yourself. And maybe some of you have, but maybe what's stopping you, I don't know, but you need to ask yourself that question. Maybe what's stopping you is simply that you just don't believe that the Father can love you. But I'm telling you, his son is a mess, and the Father runs to him and embraces him, as we see in the passage. I need to tell you this. I need you to hear it. And so if you're sitting there, lean in here and listen, hear this, that Jesus doesn't love some future version of you. He doesn't love you all cleaned up and perfect and pretty and proper and put together, but the Father runs to you in the midst of your mess, your muck, and your mire. He runs to you and embraces you with a hug. Let's go on in verse 21. It says this, and the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against you and before heaven. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Here it is again, but the Father. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. I love that last line there. It says they began to celebrate. His dad threw a party. If you're reading this right, the sons, he goes in and he's doing the I messed up speech to his father, but it's the beauty of the father is he didn't even listen to him. He says to the servant, he says, hey, go and get the best robe and a ring and get my son cleaned up. We're going to throw a party. Because this is the heart of the father, is that he wants to celebrate, and he loves his children so much that regardless of how far you've gone, his response and his answer to you would be, we're going to kill the fattened calf and we're going to celebrate because you were dead and now you're alive. That's the hope, and that's the offer on the table. That's the deal for those who would say, I'm the prodigal. I'm wayward. I feel that I've gone too far and my life's too much of a mess. And I just got to tell you, God's heart toward you would simply be that he's excited for you. He's pursuing you. And maybe this is your moment. Maybe this is that moment where he wants you to lay everything down and just come home to him, because he wants you to know what it's like to be wrapped in the robe of his love and to be celebrated and welcomed home with grace. Verse 25. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the servants and he asked him, he said, "What do these things mean?" And the servant said to him, "Your brother has come home, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he received him back safe and sound." But let's look at the older brother's response in 28. He says, "But he was angry and refused to go in. And the father came out and entreated him." Some of you, maybe you're listening today, and this is you. My hand's raised because this is me. The older brother story is the story that I identify with the most. Is it says that he's angry and frustrated, and he refuses to go into this party that he's throwing, that his father is throwing for his brother. And I just got to tell you, and this is our second point here, is that the father pursues even those who think they're perfect. Translation, the father pursues those who have tried so very hard to be good for him and missed it. It says that he was angry and refused to go in, and his father comes out to him. We can't miss that. The father pursues his children. And if you're in this place where you feel like you're the perfectionist son or the proper, that you've done all the right things, and maybe especially in this season, with the whole COVID crisis and all that's going on, people are losing jobs, and you think, "I've lived a good life, I've done all of the things, I show up to my groups and my studies, I do everything, I've done everything well, and now some hard times are hitting, and they're frustrating because you don't understand, because you feel like, God, I've done so much for you." He simply wants you to know that he loves you. He hasn't run away. He's not going anywhere. But there's an invitation to step into the party. There's an invitation even for you to step into the celebration. I love the way that C.S. Lewis puts it in his book, Mere Christianity. And he says, "No man knows how bad he is until he has tried very hard to be good." I think this is the essential problem for the older brother in the story. Is he's spent his whole life and he's tried to do everything correctly. He's done what his father said, and the younger brother runs away and has all the fun, if you will, right? Like he has all of the sin-filled fun for a while until he comes to the end of himself. And the older brother's saying, I looked after our land, I looked after our livestock, I did all of these things for you, and now he's angry because the father has killed the fattened calf and he's throwing a party for him. The older brother's caught up on this thing of all that he's done for the father. And here's the deal. If that's you, much like it's been me in my life, here's what I had to come to realize, and maybe this is helpful to you. The question for you to ask yourself is, what can you actually do? What can you actually do for the father who has everything? What is there that you can do for the father who has everything? How good is good enough? These are questions, not to be insulting, but questions for you to ponder and seriously ask yourself, because these are things that we have to work through. If you're in this place of being the older brother, and I would simply say the father's pleading with you to come in and join the party. And the question is, what will it take for you to realize the invitation? Verse 29, it says, "But he answered his father, 'Look, these many years I have served you.'" This is the "it's not fair" moment. "And I never disobeyed your commands, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, and you killed the fattened calf for him." Let's look at the father's response. You got to get this. And the father says to him, "Son, you are always with me, all that is mine is yours. Son, you're always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad because your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. I love the father's response here in the heart here. When I was getting ordained a couple months back, my brother-in-law, Zach, he came and he spoke in my ordination, and he actually used the story of the prodigal son, and he called me, he basically called me out and said, "Hey, Chris, I think you're the older brother." And I was like, "Well, thanks, bro. Maybe you're the prodigal." But seriously, he pointed out, and I had never seen this in the story before, but he said, "I say that because you've done so very good in so many things. You've done well and you've been really good for Jesus. You've led a good life. You have a beautiful family. You've done a lot of things well. But it seems that I think what you'll be challenged with is all that you've done for Jesus." And Zach pointed this out to me. Much like the father says, "Son, you were always with me." He simply said, "Jesus is far less concerned about what you can do for him and far more concerned about doing your life and your ministry with him." This is the heart of the father for the older brother. Maybe you're listening in and you're watching and you're thinking, "This is me." And there's something turning inside of you and you feel it. And more than likely, you're a control freak like most older brothers, and it's hard to let that go. But I just want to tell you, God's far less concerned about what you can do for him. He simply wants you to be in a relationship with him. That's the invitation. Here's the deal. As Jesus is telling this story, this is a parable that Jesus is telling. And if you go back to Luke 15, the first verse, it says who's Jesus' audience is. You have to, if you don't catch this, you'll miss it. You'll miss the gravity of the story is that it says that Jesus was gathering and reclining with tax collectors and sinners, prodigals, if you will. And then it says outside, there's a group of Pharisees grumbling and complaining. Jesus leaves us with this picture. He paints this picture for us in the story, and we know when we read the Gospel of Luke that Jesus is reclining with the messy, broken children, displaying the heart of the Father, and who do you have listening in but the Pharisees? Those who would have known the law, they would have known all the right and religious things to do, what they should have done for God. And I think they're listening and they're grumbling and complaining, and Jesus is trying to get them to lean in, much like he's probably trying to get you to lean in. And he's saying, "Hey, come. Come in and join me and join us. Come and be a part of the party. We want to celebrate," and the heart of the Father would be to celebrate and to invite you into the party. The crazy thing about this is that I love about the story is Jesus ends the story there. With the older brother, we don't actually know if he went into the party. We don't know if he turned and went into the party with his father or if he stayed outside angry. And I think the reality is Jesus left it there purposefully. Because he's inviting in that day and in that time when he's telling the story, he's inviting the Pharisees in. And he's leaving the ball in their court and simply saying, "Hey, you can do life for me, or you can come in to celebrate life with me." And I think that's the question that Jesus leaves the older brothers in the crowd with. Have you been trying to do life for Jesus? And now it's hit you and it's frustrating and it's hard and it's heartbreaking. You've done everything right. You feel like you've been very good, and now whether it's COVID or whether it's just something else or you've just reached this place in your faith and in your life, and it feels like it's not working. As Lewis says, you tried so hard to be good and you only realized how bad and broken you were. The invitation to you would simply be, come in. Jesus is talking to the Pharisees, and they would have known the word. And as he tells them in John 5, he says, "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it is them that bear witness to me." You know, maybe you've done all the religiously right things, but you've missed Jesus. You've missed the heart of the Father. And here's the deal is, point number three is simply this, is the Father's love is perfect. The Father's love is perfect, and here's why that's good news. That's good news because the Father, both in the story, but God the Father invites both the older and the younger brother in to the same party and the same celebration. He invites them in no matter where they're at. One's squandered everything that he's been given, and one's gotten rid of everything and wasted it and lived recklessly, and the other one's been so very good, but yet what did he miss? He missed out on the fact that the Father said, all that I have is yours. He's asking for a cow, and God's saying, I have everything. It's all yours. You've always been with me. I want to be with you. It's all yours. That's why this is good news. No matter where you're at, near or far from the Lord, he's calling you in to be in full relationship with him. He wants you regardless of what you can do for him, what you have done for him, what you've done against him. This is good news because next week is coming. This is good news because on Friday we celebrate really one of the darkest and most heartbreaking events of history, where we see that Jesus is beaten and his body's broken, and we talk about it in communion. And Friday wouldn't be good if Sunday didn't happen, but then we celebrate next Sunday, Easter. Jesus rose from the grave. They go to the tomb and it's empty, and Jesus rises. And that's why this is good news, is because Jesus did what he said he was going to do so that all of our sin could be covered. Those who are self-righteous and those who know that they're so broken and so messy and so lost. We get to look to next week and we get to see love on display. The heart of the Father on display. And I don't know where you're at right now, but maybe God's talking to you. And maybe he wants you to know, I'm coming after you. Maybe he just wants you to turn around, and as we sang before and as we'll sing in a little, that he wants you to run to him. And when you do, as the song says, you will simply fall into grace. And he'll love you. The offer is on the table for you, regardless of where you're at, to come in and to celebrate and to be a part of God's family and his perfect love. What's stopping you? Would you pray with me? Father, you're so good to us. Lord, you're so good, regardless of whether we've been messy or broken, or we've just tried so hard to be good. Lord, your heart would be that you would wipe away all of that. And despite how good or bad or everything in between we have been, that you would say, I love you and you're my child. I'm going to wrap you into a robe of love. I'm going to go outside when you're angry and call you in to the party. God, we love you. Lord, we thank you for Jesus and the love that you put on display in the cross. We praise you. We love you. And it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
He gave it.
you for joining us today. And if anyone has heard the messages and heard the songs and you really feel like you need to change your life and you want to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, please contact us. Fill out a connection card there online. You can call the office. You can email the office. We have prayer cards as well online. All of those are available. Don't miss that opportunity. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your grace in Jesus. Again, we praise you for being a God that knows us inside and out and takes care of us. And while we go through these difficult times, these hard times, walk with us. We seek your peace, the peace of knowing the hope we have in Jesus. Let it be prevalent. Let it be overwhelming in our lives so everything else just fades away. Father, walk with us every single day in the days to come. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi guys, thank you so much for joining us online today. It was awesome hearing from Pastor Chris on just how the Lord meets us in our brokenness and our mess. If you have any takeaways from today and you want to share those in the comments, feel free to do so. If you want to stick around for our post show, we're about to make that happen too. So thanks for joining us today. Welcome back to the Post Show, where we like to keep things a little lighthearted, but also inform you on what's going on. We'd love to remind you about the Connect cards, the prayer cards, and the giving links that you can go ahead and find in the comments. You can also find those on our website, university.church, and also on our UCC Hub app.
Earlier this week on Instagram and Facebook, we set out a poll asking you for your help to figure out, is it life group or life group? And you all were so helpful. The votes came back in and there were 25 of you that said it's life group, one word, and 28 of you that said life group. This gives us a 53-47 split. No. So I've been thinking. Now hear me out. If it is a life group, but it's a group of people doing life together, are you inherently calling it the same thing that which it does? So it is not only a noun, but also a verb, which in turns means you could probably use either one of these and still be correct. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Taylor.
It's obviously life group.
Obviously, we know what Taylor voted for. I also voted for that, if we're. Some of you had really strong opinions on this. I don't know, but we wanted to tell you a little bit more about starting an online life group in the meantime.
Like Lizzie said, starting an online life group with the people around you is simple. We want you to make sure you're equipped with the resources you need to do this. Each week, our discipleship minister sends out a 3/3 guide you can use to facilitate your group with. This provides a time for your group to build community, dive into God's word,
make applications of the scriptures you're reading, and pray for each other. If you'd like to get involved in a life group or start one online, please email John at university.church.
We can't wait for this week. Be sure to like our Facebook page and follow us on Instagram, and definitely make sure that you're staying up to date by interacting with us on our website, university.church. Well, that's about all we have for you guys this morning, or afternoon, I guess, since we have our extra services now. How exciting. We are always online at Facebook, Instagram, and on our website, and would love to hear from you. But that's all we have for this week, so we're gonna go ahead and say bye.
Bye.
Bye.